So today, rules of conditional proof or deduction theorem. So we shall now introduce the third inference rule known as CP or rule of conditional proof. Rule of conditional proof. So rule CP, if we can derive S from R and a set of premises, then we can derive R implication S from the set of premises alone. So if So what is the rule of CP? Suppose we have n premises. Suppose we have n premises, h1, h2, and so on, hn, which implies c1 implication c2, which implies c1 implication c2. Ante conclusion having conditional connective. Conclusion having conditional connective. Okay. When conclusion statement formula contains a conditional connective, we shall use the rule CP. We shall use rule CP. Okay. So what is rule P? Rule CP. Suppose we are having n premises. Suppose we are having n premises. Premises means H1, H2, and so on, Hn, which implies C1. Implication C2. Implication means conditional. C1 implication C2. So when the conclusion statement formula contains conditional connective or implication connective, when the conclusion formula contains a conditional connective, we can use rule CP. We can use rule CP. Okay. So let P denote the conjunction of the set of premises. So here P and R implication S, which is equivalent to P implication R implication S. So here given premise P and R implication S, we have to derive P implication R implication S. In this, the conclusion contains conditional connective. Okay. In such cases, we use rule CP. Conditional proof. CP means conditional proof. So let P denote the conjunction of the set of premises and let R be any formula. The above equivalence states that if R is included as an additional premise and S is derived from P and R, then R implication S can be derived from the premises P alone. So rule CP is also called the deduction theorem and is generally used if the conclusion of the form R implication S. Suppose H1, H2 and so on, Hn, which implies C1 implication C2. This is the given argument. Okay. In this conclusion statement is C1 implication C2. So here conclusion statement contains conditional connective. In this case, it is enough to prove H1, H2 and so on, Hn, comma C1. So along these premises, we have to take left hand side of the conclusion. Left hand side means in this example, we take the conclusion C1 implication C2. So in this conditional statement, we are having C1 in left hand side. So along these given n premises, we add this C1 also. Okay. That C1 is called assumed premise. The C1, you can take it as assumed premise. So it is enough to prove. Finally, we derive C2. Okay. Finally, we derive C2. When the conclusion formula contains conditional connective, when the conclusion statement formula contains a conditional connective, we shall use the rule CP. So what is the rule CP? Suppose we have n premises, H1, H2 and so on, Hn, which implies C1 implication C2, which implies C1 implication C2. Here conclusion having conditional connective. So in such cases, we apply rule CP. So for this, it is enough to prove if H1, H2 and so on, Hn comma C1, which implies C2. It is enough to prove H1, H2 and so on Hn. C1 implies C2. So along the n premises, you take the left hand side of the conclusion as an additional premise. Left hand side of the conclusion as an additional premise. In this C1, you take it as an additional premise. Okay. Coming to problem, show that R implication S can be derived from the premises P implication Q implication S negation R R P and Q negation R R P and Q. Okay, so here P implication Q implication S negation R R P and Q are given premises. From these premises, we have to derive R implication S. This is conclusion. So in here, conclusion containing the conditional statement. Here, conclusion containing the conditional statement. Okay. So for this, it is enough to prove. So here, given premises considering P implication, Q implication S, negation R, RP and Q. Along these premises, we assumed another premise, that is left hand side of the given conclusion. Left hand side, here left hand side is R. So we have to add this R to given premises and finally we derive S. So instead of deriving R implication S, we shall include R as an additional premise and show S. Okay. So first given premise negation RRP. So rule P. So given premise. So rule P. So we take it R as the additional premise, that is assumed premise. So it is also rule P. And from these 1 and 2 steps, negation RRP R by applying disjunctive syllogism. So disjunctive syllogism R and negation R R P, which gives the conclusion P R variable and negation of the variable disjunctive with another variable, it gives the conclusion that variable P. So this is disjunctive syllogism. Okay, so here we derive the formula from 1 and 2 steps. From 1 and 2 steps. So by applying disjunctive syllogism. So next I take the premise P implication, Q implication, S, which involves P. Which involves P. So rule P and from 3rd and 4th steps by modus ponens rule, by applying modus ponens rule. So what is modus ponens rule? P and P implication Q, which gives Q. In place of Q, we are having Q implication S. So we derive the formula here, Q implication S. This is rule T from 3rd and 4th step and applying modus ponens rule. Applying modus ponens rule. In 6th step, we introduce another premise Q. Another premise Q. Okay. So Q implication is Q. Q implication is Q. So here, this is rule P from 5 and 6. We are also applying modus ponens rule. Modus ponens rule. So Q and Q implication is, which gives the conclusion S. So this is our rule CP. So finally we write this step R implication S by rule CP. Okay. So given premise negation RRP, this is rule P. R, this is assumed premise. And from these two steps, we derive the formula T, rule T, from 1, 2 and disjunctive syllogism. So next we introduce another premise, P implication, Q implication, S. So this is rule P. And from 3 and 4th steps, we derive Q implication S. So rule T from 3 and 4th steps and by applying modus ponens rule. In 6th step, we introduce another premise Q by applying modus ponens rule to 5th and 6th steps, we finally derive S. Okay. So finally, R implication S, rule CP. So this is right hand side of the given conclusion. So left hand side, we are assumed the premise, and right hand side, S is the derived conclusion. So from this, we write R implication S by rule CP. Okay. Next one. Show that P implication S can be derived from the premises negation P or Q, negation Q or R, and R implication S. So in this given problem, negation P or Q, negation Q or R, and R implication S, these are given premises. From these we derive P implication S. P implication S. Okay. So here the conclusion having conditional statement. Conclusion having conditional statement. So here we are applying rule CP by assuming left hand side of the given conclusion as a additional premise. Okay, so here left hand side variable is P. So in derivation, we consider P as a assumed premise. Finally, we derive the conclusion with S. Okay, so P implication S is the conclusion. So in this conclusion, it contains conditional connective. So we apply rule CP. So in this, along these given premises, we add left hand side of the conclusion. So that premise is P. So P as considered as assumed premise to derive S. So first we take negation P or Q. First premise, negation P or Q. This is given premise. So here we mentioned rule P. And in second step, we consider P. This is assumed premise. From these two steps, 1 and 2, we derived Q. So derived Q. So it is rule T by disjunctive syllogism. So here, what is disjunctive syllogism? P and negation P or Q. P and negation P or Q, which gives Q. P and negation P or Q, which gives Q. Okay, rule T from 1, 2 steps and by applying disjunctive syllogism. So in 4th step, we introduce another premise, negation Q or R. So that is rule P, negation Q or R, that is rule P. So from 3rd and 4th step, here also we applying disjunctive syllogism. We get R as the conclusion. We get R as the conclusion. So rule T from 3 and 4th step by applying disjunctive syllogism. Next, we introduce another premise, R implication S. That is rule P. So from 5 and 6th steps, applying modus ponens rule R and R implication S, we conclude with S. Okay, so we conclude with S. So this is our required conclusion. So rule T from 5166, by applying modus ponens. Finally, we write P implication is, yes. So by rule CP. By rule CP, okay? Next problem. If there was a ball game, then traveling was difficult. If there was a ball game, then traveling was difficult. If they arrived on time, then traveling was not difficult. Then traveling was not difficult. They arrived on time. Therefore, there was no ball game. Show that these statements constitute a valid argument. These statements constitute a valid argument. Means here, the given premises is in sentence formula. Sentence formula, first we write atomic variables. So in this, first atomic variable is, given condition is, if there was a ball game, then traveling was difficult. In this sentence, the condition is if then condition. If there was a ball game, then traveling was difficult. So from this, we write two atomic statements. So let us indicate the statement as follows. First, P, there was a ball game. There was a ball game. And another atomic statement is traveling was difficult. Traveling was difficult. That is Q. Okay. If they arrived on time, then traveling was not difficult. If they arrived on time, then traveling was not difficult. So here another atomic statement is they arrived on time. Okay. Traveling was not difficult. Here already we mentioned traveling was difficult. Here traveling was not difficult means negation Q. Okay. So they arrived on time. Here our proposition is they arrived on time. So therefore, here therefore treats like conclusion. Therefore treats like conclusion. So the conclusion of these statements is there was no ball game. Show that these statements constitute a valid argument. So we have to show given premises derive a valid argument. Okay. So first solution, let us indicate the statements as follows. So first statement is there was a ball game. And second statement is traveling was difficult. And third statement is they arrived on time. They arrived on time. So if we write using these statements, given sentences in symbolic form, given sentences in symbolic form. Hence the given premises are, first premise is if there was a ball game, then traveling was difficult. If there was a ball game, then traveling was difficult. So here, if then condition means P implication Q. So if there was a ball game, then traveling was difficult. This is first premise. Okay. If there was a ball game, then traveling was difficult. This is first premise. And another statement, if they arrived on time, then traveling was not difficult. If they arrived on time. So arrived on time variable is R. So if they arrived on time, then traveling is not difficult. So here we consider negation Q or implication negation Q or implication negation Q. And they arrived on time. And another premise is they arrived on time. So it stands alone. And R. These are given premises. P implication Q, R implication negation Q, and R. In before problems, they mentioned like in symbolic form. In this example, they're given like in sentences. Okay. So first we consider the atomic statements and then we write premises in symbolic form. P implication Q, R implication negation Q and R. So once again, if there was a ball game, then traveling was difficult. So if there was a ball game, then traveling was difficult. Okay. For next statement, if they arrived on time, then traveling was not difficult. Not means negation. So that's why here we mentioned before Q, negation symbol. Okay. R implication, negation Q. If they arrived on time, then traveling was not difficult. If they arrived on time, traveling was not difficult. And they arrived on time. This statement standing alone. So, and the statement variable is R. So, and R. So, in this, therefore treated like conclusion. So, the conclusion is, so conclusion statement enti, there was no ball game. So, ball game denotes atomic variable enti P. So, there was no ball game means negation. So, the conclusion is negation P. The conclusion is negation P. Okay. So, using these premises, we have to conclude negation P. So, negation P manamu derive cheyagaligite, adi valid argument avutundi. If in case manam derive cheyalekapothe, adi invalid argument avutundi. Okay na? So, show that these statements constitute a valid argument. This is the question. So, first, in these premises, first we consider R implication, negation, Q. R implication, negation, Q. So, this is given premises, rule P. And again, we introduce second premise, R, rule P. From these two steps, 1 and 2, by modus ponens. So, what is modus ponens? P and P implication Q, which concludes Q. So, in place of Q, we are having negation Q. So, that is rule P from 1 and 2 steps and applying the rule modus ponens. Okay. So, in fourth steps, we introduce another premise P implication Q. So, that is rule P. Okay. So, the contrapositive statement of P implication Q is negation Q implication negation P. That is rule P for fourth step. Only from fourth step we derive the statement negation Q implication negation P by contrapositive statement of P implication Q. So the statement is P implication Q, which is equivalent to negation Q implication negation P. Okay. So from three and fourth steps, three and fifth steps. Third step is negation Q and fifth step is negation Q implication negation P. Negation Q and negation Q implication negation P. Okay. So from these third and fourth fifth steps, we applying modus ponens rule, we derive the formula negation P. So that is rule T from third and fifth step and applying modus ponens. Okay. So the conclusion is negation P. So the given statements constitute a valid argument. The given statement constitute a valid argument. Okay. Next one. By using the method of derivation, show that the following statements constitute a valid argument. So this problem also like before one. So first statement is, if A works hard, then either B or C will enjoy. Okay. If B enjoys, then A will not work hard. If B enjoys, then C will not. Therefore, if A works hard, B will not enjoy. In given statement, therefore treats like conclusion. So, what we have to prove? If A works hard, B will not enjoy. If A works hard, B will not enjoy. Okay. So first we indicate statements in symbolic form. So given premises are the first statement. If A works hard for P proposition, A works hard, and for Q proposition, B will enjoy. For R proposition, C will enjoy. Okay, B will enjoy, C will enjoy. Totally, we have three propositions. First proposition for P, A works hard. For Q, B will enjoy. For R, C will enjoy. So using these propositions, we write the premises. A works hard, then either B or C will enjoy. B or C. So B will enjoy means Q proposition. C will enjoy means R proposition. So we write this statement in symbolic form like this. If A works hard, P. If then condition. So conditional connective. B or C will enjoy. So Q or R. Okay. Q or R. For R, we are using connective disjunctive R. So the first premise is P implication Q or R. So the statement is if A works hard, then either B or C will enjoy. Either B or C will enjoy. Next statement is if B enjoys. So B enjoy is the proposition for Q. So Q implication, then A will not work hard. So A will work hard is P. A will not work hard means negation P. So if B enjoys, then A will not work hard. Then A will not work hard. Okay. And another statement, if D enjoys, if D enjoys, in fourth proposition, D enjoy, D will enjoy. That is S. So S implication, then C will not. C will not. C will enjoy means R. C will not means negation R. S implication, negation R. S implication, negation R. Okay. So the conclusion is, therefore, if A works hard, if A works hard, so P implication, D will not enjoy. So D will enjoy proposition is yes. So D will not enjoy means negation yes. So the conclusion is P implication, negation yes. So we have to prove P implication, negation yes from these premises. So the given premises is P implication, Q implication R. So Q implication, negation P, and S implication, negation R. So here, you observe here, the conclusion contains conditional statement, conditional connective. The conclusion contains conditional connective. So here we apply conditional proof, rule CP. So for this, we treat P as a given premise or additional premise. Okay, P is also one premise, that is additional premise. So for these given premises, we add left hand side of the conclusion, that is P as a assumed premise. Finally, we have to derive negation S. Finally, we have to derive negation S. So we include P as an additional premise and derive negational S. So first we consider additional premise P, that is rule P, additional premise, and another related premise we consider here, P containing premise. So in given premises, first premise containing P. So we introduce here P implication Q or R. So rule P. So from one and two steps. So one P and P implication Q or R. From one and two steps, we derive Q or R. By modus ponens rule. By modus ponens rule. So what is modus ponens rule? P and P implication, Q which gives Q. In place of Q, we are having Q or R. In place of Q, we are having Q or R. So that is rule T from 1-2 step by applying modus ponens rule. By applying modus ponens rule. Next step. Third step, we are having Q or R. That is rule T from 1-2 and modus ponens. And we consider here another derived. So Q or R, we know that the standard formula P implication Q, which is equivalent to negation P or Q. So here negation missing andi. So negation P or Q. So P implication Q, which is equivalent to negation P or Q. Negation P, here negation P. Negation P or Q. So in place of Q or R, we write negation Q implication R. Negation Q implication R. Rule T by applying this rule. Okay. So for this, we write contrapositive statement. Negation R implication. Negation of negation Q. Negation of negation Q, which is equal to Q. So negation R implication Q. This is also rule T from fourth step. And applying the equivalence relation P implication Q, which is equivalent to negation Q implication negation P. So now we introduce the premise which contains Q, which having Q. So in fifth step, we are having negation R implication Q. We introduce here Q implication negation P. That is given premise, so that is rule P. From 5 and 6th step, by hypothetical syllogism, we write negation or implication negation P. Negation or implication negation P. So what is hypothetical syllogism? P implication Q, Q implication R, which is equivalent to P implication R. P implication Q, Q implication R, which is equivalent to P implication R. So negation R implication negation P. Okay. From seventh step, this is in contrapositive statement. From this we write P implication R. So rule T from seventh step, and we applying the contrapositive P implication Q, which is equivalent to negation Q implication negation P. From this equivalence relation, we derive P implication R. Okay. In ninth step, we introduce another premise, S implication negation R. This is given premise. So rule P. This is given premise. So rule P. And from ninth step, we also apply here contrapositive statement. Negation of negation R becomes R. Implication negation S. Negation of negation R. Implication negation S. Negation of negation R becomes R. R implication negation S. Rule T from ninth step. Applying the rule P implication Q, which is equivalent to negation Q implication negation P. Okay. So P implication negation S. From 8th and 10th steps. So 8th step P implication R. In 10th step, R implication negation S. By applying hypothetical syllogism to 8th and 10th step, we derive the formula P implication negation S. P implication negation S. From 8th and 10th step, by applying hypothetical syllogism. Okay. So from 1 and 11, in one first step, we are having P. So that by P and negation S from first and 11th step, applying modus ponens, we derive negation S, rule T. This is our conclusion, negation S. By rule CP, final step, we write P implication negation S.